So, in this talk, I will present the activity I've done at the beginning with Massimiliano Pierbon, that I see here, and with the support then of my PhD students, Francesca Ratti and Fardad Vakilipur, and the most recent one on semantic information. And so, this is an activity I'm conducting with. Professor Pasquale Stano. This is the classical schema we have in molecular communication. So we have some chemical reactions in the transmitter. So these release molecules, these propagate and reach the receiver. So when we consider this model, the problem is that of evaluating what is the transfer of information. And when we speak of information, typically we think to the classical approach of Shannon, and we use measures of information that were introduced by Shannon, like the entropy that define the quantity of information that characterize the source, mutual information that gives a measure of the mutual dependence we have between two random variables. And another important quantity is the relative entropy, which measures the distance between two distributions. So this is also known as Kullback-Leibler divergence, and these two distributions are defined on the same sample space. The mutual information can be expressed in terms of relative entropy. And the important is of the mutual information is that if we consider the maximization of this mutual information over all the input distribution, we are able to find the capacity of the channel. So the maximum rate at which we can send information over the channel and recover at the receiver the information with vanishing low probability of error. Typically, the capacity is known for a very limited number of channel models. Channel model, when I speak of channel model, I mean a channel that can be described in a statistical way by giving the conditional probability of the output given the input. When it's not possible, and for most of the cases, it's not possible to evaluate the capacity in a closed form, we resort to the computation of upper and lower bounds. The upper bound typically can be expressed one of the ways by considering the relative entropy that I introduced before, and the lower bound came straightforwardly from the evaluation of the from the maximization of the mutual information. The problem is that this kind of bound can be evaluated again in situation where we have a model of the channel. But when we consider the molecular communication field, typically we don't have at least if we consider a real system, even if we have a model, we do not have a very clear description of the statistical model of the channel. So we have it in theory, but in practice, we are not able to consider most of the nonlinear effect that happen in a molecular communication system. So the idea here is to apply methods. There are several methods that have been proposed in the literature, but when you don't have a clear channel model, you resort to, you can apply numerical evaluation techniques. And one of the approach that we develop is a data-driven approach for the estimation of channel capacity of a biological system, how it works. So typically, when you have a biological circuit, data driven approaches can be apply with the goal of the optimizing the two bounds that we have seen before, with the hope that these two bounds are close each other. So the difference between the two is very tight. And this evaluation must be done typically considering data that you can obtain by simulation or experiment. So you generate, you apply inputs and you observe the output, you collect the data and you try to characterize the input-output relation. And so in our work, we have considered the application of this technique, so this statistical, empirical statistical description, in a very basic system that is the one that I described before, where we implemented in silico simulation to generate a data set that describe the time evolution of the output given the input. So these simulations typically are very long, and also also if we consider experiments are very even more even longer. And so typically the problem is that of collecting enough number of data in order to characterize in a very good empirical way the input-output relation. So the solution that we propose was that of defining a data augmentation approach module to generate new samples in order to fit any required distribution without the need to run new simulation. And this was obtained by combining machine learning and statistical sampling. And so thanks to this data augmentation module, we were able to mimic the generation of new samples that are not available from the data you are collecting. So you can understand that using these new samples that are able to capture this estimation. So because at the end we use this data to estimate the probability density at the output, considering to reproduce at the output data that follow the distribution that you expect from the data that you have generated at the input. And this approach has the advantage that we are able to capture the stochasticity of the biological process. And we devise an approach that is able to find the distribution at the input that maximize that provide a good estimate for the capacity, because the approach that we used, as I said, is collect biological data from some experiment or from some simulation, implement the data augmentation, and try to find a family of parametric probability distribution, and we selected the beta binomial because it's a discrete probability, apply optimization, and the goal of this optimization was that of observing the evolution or the convergence of the upper and lower bound. And so we are able to find the parameters that give the input distribution that provide the best distribution of the input for the two bounds. And these are the results. These are the results that we have obtained with for the data that I showed you before. And you can see that there is a good convergence between the upper and the lower bound. So this is one of the first results that I want to show in this presentation. The second is about the shift, because the one that we have seen now consists in applying some new methods to obtain empirical data and good estimates of this the probability load that we need to apply the classical measure of informations that were introduced by Shannon. But as we know, when we consider the transfer of information in living, especially in living system, the information that we transfer typically is not only related to the uncertainty that is characterized by the probability of emitting symbol from a source, because typically we have a meaning that is associated with the information that you are transferring from the transmitter to the receiver. So this leads to the concept of semantic information. Semantic information, if we start with the question, what is information? Actually, the information is related to the communication of knowledge. So this is the typical thinking we have about information. But we know from the Shannon theory that we, as engineers, we typically characterize this information in a syntactic way by describing, as I said before, the phenomenon that we have in a probabilistic way. What is missing, and this was also recognized and stated by Shannon, is that we don't care about the semantic aspect of our information. And so the problem is that there is a lack of importance of the message that we are transferring. And this is the problem that we try to address. So semantic information was born with the idea of trying to assign a measure to the meaning of a message. And it, as you know, is maybe most of you know, is a new paradigm that is quite studied also in telecommunication in 6G system. And still, there is no common quantitative definition of semantic information. So the question is, if it is possible to introduce a quantitative measure of semantic information. Before considering this problem, I maybe try to underline what are the difference between conventional syntactic communication and semantic communication. So the problem in syntactic communication is that of reproducing in a reliable way the information that was produced by at the source. And so you know that typically this is done by first implementing source coding, and typically then this is followed, this is followed by channel coding, and at the receiver you have the reverse of this operation. But the problem is to reproduce at the destination in a reliable way what you have generated at the transmitter. The paradigm change when we consider the communication between intelligent agents, because as I said at the beginning, the idea is to focus on living systems. So in this case, the goal is to transfer understanding the meaning between the transmitter and the receiver. So typically this can be done in different ways, but the most important aspect is that the problem is not the perfect and reliable reconstruction of what you have generated at the transmitter, but is semantic fidelity. So what you are able to interpret at the receiver, how you are able to interpret this information at the receiver. And so when we focus and we start thinking to semantic information, we must take into consideration this aspect. So the amount of information that we want to transfer is related to the semantic content, not to the probability of C. What is important is the specific content of each message, and not the average information that is associated with all the messages that can be emitted by our source. Typically, the amount of information is related to the level of knowledge that is shared between the source and the destination at the time we are implementing the communication. And the correctness is interpreted with the effectiveness we have in achieving a goal. How can this be, this concept that we have just explained, can be applied to the context of biological system? Typically, as also Michael explained before, one of the problem is to design efficient genetic circuits. And this is one of the most challenging aspects we have in genetic engineering. So this is time consuming, unreliable. But even if we are able to build this very basic circuit, so there is a lot of room to increase the complexity. And so typically it's very difficult, even if we implement these genetic circuits, typically you have nonlinear dynamics that cannot be achieved by only combining logic gates. So this is something that we must take into account. So an approach that we can use to overcome this problem is to introduce agent-based modeling. So we can think to a system as a collection of autonomous decision-making entities that typically are referred as agents, and we are able to by this modeling we are able to describe the qualitative spatiotemporal behavior of the single agent by considering the interaction it has with the environment. So the aspect that is very important is the interaction between the agent and the environment. Why I underline this aspect? Because according to the activity that I'm conducting with some colleagues, the idea and the approach that we use to measure semantic information is the one that was proposed by Kolchinsky and Wolper, that is exactly based on the concept of autonomous agents. So the autonomous agents can be talked as representative of a physical dynamical system who has a goal. The goal is to maintain their own existence in a certain environment. So the goal is intrinsic in the system. So they want to stay alive at the end, no? And the self-maintenance existence of a system can be defined in terms of a low entropy state. So typically this is related to non-equilibrium statistical physics. And this, according to the approach of Kolchinsky and Wolpert, is the key to define a measure of semantic information. Semantic information, according to their definition, is the part of the information that has a meaning for the physical system. In which sense? In the sense that, in fact, they took inspiration from this work of Carlo Rovelli, is the information that a physical system has about the environment that is causally necessary for the system to maintain its own existence over time. So The problem that we, the constraint that we consider are the maintenance of the existence. So how can we define the degree of existence of a system? And causal necessity, so how can we are able to discriminate the causal relation that have a meaning compared to the one that do not have a meaning? And so this is the key is the description of the physical world in two subsystems, the system and the environment. So, as I said before, the degree of existence of the system X that is interacting with the environment is defined as the its ability to remain in a state from that is far from the equilibrium. And this can be measured by defining this viability function. The viability function is equal to the negative of the Shannon entropy, because we want to consider low entropy states. As you know, we must define an interaction between the system and the environment, because the problem is to understand what are the causal relations. So how the system is able to affect the evolution of the system. So as when you move in a place, you know, you typically are aware of the environment that surrounds you. But what happens, and so this can be talked at the beginning, so from your hypothetical instant time equal to zero. So, but what happens if the environment around you change? So this can be described by introducing a scrambling of the environment. This typically is implemented by the coarse graining function that is used in information theory. And you can compute the mutual information of the joint distribution of the state of your system and of the environment after you apply this scrambling of the environment. This scrambling of the environment is called intervention. It's a concept that was introduced by Judea Pearl sometime ago. And you can compute the mutual information, the viability function for each this scrambling of the environment. So it's like that you modify the environment around you and you see how the system evolves. And we can define the optimal intervention as the one that is able to achieve at a specific time the same viability of your original system. And we can define the mutual information, the semantic information as the minimum of the mutual information that we have between the system and the environment that are able to achieve the same viability at a given function. So you see, the viability of the system is not changed. What changed is the description of the interaction between the environment and your system. So the problem is that of characterizing this channel, because at this point we see the mutual information between the system and the environment define a channel between the environment and the system. So it's like you perturb the equilibrium of the agent that is observed in the environment, and you are able to see how it evolves. And so you can discriminate between what is meaningful in term information that the system is able to obtain from the environment and what is not able, is not relevant. How can we apply to synthetic cells? Actually, as we know, synthetic cells are not alive. and can be better considered as a sort of molecular machines that rather than minimal organism. And they are a very new important tool that can be used in applied research. And one of the applications is to use them as smart agents for drug, protein, or gene delivery. So in this context, synthetic cell can be described as programmable vehicles that interact with the biological environment. And so this is what we have talked with my colleague Pasquale. We have devised a scenario where we apply the Kolchinsky-Walker approach to synthetic cell. And the case that we have considered is a synthetic cell that acts as an agent embedded in an environment. And the goal, the intrinsic goal of the cell is to the synthetic cell is to sense the environment. So we are able to sense the presence of signaling molecules that are emitted by the cancer cell and release move towards the cancerous cell and release the drug when it's approaching this this cancerous cell. Actually, this is the main description. But behind this, there is a state variable modeling of the environment. So we define the environment by describing as a single state variable that describe the level of signal molecules that is released by the cancerous cell. And the synthetic cell is described as the product of three state variables. The variable is XPER that is related to the perception of the signaling molecule in the environment. The internalization of this signaling molecule and the precursor molecule that is a molecule that is used by the synthetic cell to produce the toxin. And this is the system that we have considered. So this is the main idea. And these are the results that we have obtained. As you see here, we have an example of actual distribution. So when you don't implement any intervention of the environment, and you here an example of intervened distribution. So you observe a change of the viability. And here you have evaluation of the mutual information that is computed for the given description of the initial characterization of the state, the environment of the system. As you can observe, so for the same value of viability, you can have different values of mutually information, and we take the one, the minimum mutual information as the one that we consider as semantic information. Why the minimum? Because it's the minimum that does not change the behavior of your system. So it is the information that is relevant for our system. So this concludes my talks. I thank you for the attention.